St. Johnsbury Athenaeum. We were inspired by Poem City, and we thank Alicia Hingston and Ann Campbell for bringing the concept to St. Johnsbury. The committee members, Bill Biddle, Sharon Biddle, Beth Cannell, Katie Moritz, and others. And we thank the hosts of the events throughout this month. We had this month because it's National Poetry Month, which I'm sure you're all aware of. We thank the hosts, Bob Jolly and the Athenaeum, and their staff and participants. We thank the Tap Room and for having a slam poet event with Jeff Hewitt, and Gato Nero for hosting a poetry reading with Beth Cannell. And we're happy to be here this evening with Peter Money and Partridge Boswell and Whit Van Meter for their program called Los Lorcas, Poetry and Music. The next PoemTown event, and the real last one, is a reception at Catamount Arts for the people who participated and submitted their poems. If you come early and sign up, you'll have an opportunity possibly to read. The schedule is loose. There will be socializing 5 to 5:30, 5:30 to 6:30, or 6:45, the readings. And I hope most of you who participated will be able to come. Moving on, just a short recap of what the Athenaeum has for events coming up. And before I go any further, I should introduce myself. I always forget to do that. My name is Sharon McCaffrey. I'm a librarian here at the Athenaeum. A program for First Wednesday series will be Wednesday, May 4th at 7. It's entitled The Memoir Boom, Who, What, Why. Dartmouth professor and experimental memoirist Irene Kakandis discusses current approaches to life writing and considers why we continue to love reading about others' lives. That program is underwritten by Bill and Sharon Biddle. We have a Read With Me workshop Tuesday, May 10th and 17th, 5:30 to 7:30. This is a program sponsored by the Humanities Council and is designed for parents who may not have as much experience reading books with children, who wish to learn about age-appropriate books and how to engage in children conversation, and who could benefit from having books at home to share with their children. They provide for free sets of new children's books for each participating household. If you would like to come, you need to reserve a spot with our youth services librarian, Adele West Fisher, in the back there. So please contact us here. Our next Arts and Culture series will be Tuesday, May 24th at 7. It is entitled Very Short Tales from Syria by Osama Alomar. A prominent practitioner of the Arabic very short story form, Osama Alomar published three collections of stories and a volume of poetry in his native Syria before events pushed him into exile. Now living in Chicago, Alomar's work has appeared in English translation in a variety of literary reviews and journals, including Plowshares, New Yorker Online, and Southern Review. Alomar will appear with his translator, who happens to be an Athenaeum librarian, Christian Collins. And then, if you're in the mood to go grooving on a Saturday evening, please come to our gala this year. Gala and Silent Auction, Saturday, May 14th at 7, celebrating the 60s with food, beer, and wine, music, and dancing. Tritium Well will play. Tickets are $40 each or two for $75. So dig out those faded jeans and love beads and have a good time. Now for this evening, I'm very happy. This is a return performance, slightly changed. I'm very happy to have this program again. I gave an introduction last year when they were part of the Readings in the Gallery series, and it actually went really well. So my theory is if it goes well the first time, don't change it. So I would like to continue by saying that Los Lorcas Poetry and Performance is just a great program. I'm going to talk a little bit about Peter. Peter decided to become a poet when he was in Northern Ireland through a program at Oberlin College. An experience with a gun and a checkpoint there prompted him to create a literary magazine, and others followed. On his way around the world to New York College to study with John Ashbery, he ended up with Allen Ginsberg. He was a teacher and a mentor to him. He has combined poetry with music, as CD Square composer Mike Sell, with art, creating poem boxes, and with comics, as a teacher at the Center for Cartoon Studies. He has collaborated with other poets, such as Saadi Youssef, an Iraqi poet, writer, and political activist, creating a hybrid of work of prose poem sequencing. He seems to be as comfortable in a distant village in India as he is being a stay-at-home dad. He is a teacher and a librarian. He's married to a librarian and has indeed lived a life of poetry. Peter and Partridge have had a long-standing collaboration. Partridge as a managing editor and Peter as a founding director of Harbor Mountain Press, a nonprofit that fosters the work of other poets. Partridge describes himself as the collector of words, images, and overheard conversations. Unlike Peter, Partridge did not focus on poetry until later in life. In school, music was his focus. He played in a Vermont band called The Cows. He tried law and then became a promoter of the arts as an arts administrator of Pentangle Council for Arts in Woodstock and the Lebanon Opera House. He began writing poetry after his children were born, but it took an overwhelming loss to drive him with intensity to write poetry seriously. In the fall of 2011, Peter asked him whether he considered sending his poems to the Grolier Discovery Award. His book, Some Far Country, won the title for 2013. Peter wrote this about Partridge's work in an email. There is a precision and rage somehow, and this is poetry's trick on the poet. With enough levity and cunning to get both author and reader through tough parts. And this is precisely why we publish. This event will join their individual collections of work with the music of guitarist Whit Van Meter, a graduate of Berklee College of Music and Vermont College of Fine Arts. Whit is a composer and an arranger and has performed his music with Diane Mosier's composer's big band. A special guest of the Vermont Jazz Ensemble. I welcome them and am going to turn you over to their wonderful program and enjoy. Thank you.
move your voice, Mike.
Let's see what we can do about that. It's a new setup. New setup. Thanks. Okay, perfect. Thank you. Thanks, Sharon. And that's a perfect segue to saying thank you for coming, and thanks for Sharon for arranging my microphones, and to Bob and to everyone here at the Athenaeum for having us back here. It's great to be back, and we hope you've been having a very festive poetry month. We still have a few more days, so we're going to make the most of it tonight. And that first number, which you heard the music of and hopefully a few of the words, is called The Climb. It was inspired by the poet Federico Garcia Lorca, from whom we take our name. And he wrote, "The duende climbs up inside you from the soles of the feet," and hence The Climb. And we're going to climb into a few more poems, some more music. I'll read a few poems. Peter's going to read some. We're going to weave some music in and out and around and through as we go along. And we're going to have a lot of fun. So thanks for joining us. We hope you enjoy it. I'd like to start off with a poem that comes to us by way of India, from the Bhagavad Gita, by way of a summer cycling race in France, by way of a cathedral in the town of Piran, Slovenia, where I happened upon a painting that's even more immense than this beer stuff behind me. It's actually about three times the size of this behind me in this the Cathedral of St. George. And I hope you enjoy it. It's called Champs-Élysées, and it comes with an epigraph from Willie Nelson, of all people, who said, "I think it is terrible and disgusting how everyone has treated Lance Armstrong, especially after what he achieved. When I was on drugs, I couldn't even find my bike." Every action Krishna enjoins Arjuna is surrounded by defects as fire is surrounded by smoke. I.e., it's fine to appear at the starting line drunk or smoke a pack of Gauloises from Evian to Parc des Princes, as Pietro Vittorino did in the golden days, winning three stages and the mountains jersey, including victories atop the mythic airless heights of Alpe d'Huez and Mont Ventoux. And who didn't idolize sprinting a Jacques Darnac, who swore the bottle of absinthe he guzzled as pious as a postulant before every stage gave his legs the rapid-fire reflex of a Citroën's pistons. Each glory-bent masochist has his system, his magic beans, his shoulder chip and secret asterisk to fetish a grail and separate him from the blinded peloton, rolling through countryside otherwise too sublime not to gasp, and pause indefinitely, lingering along a line of plane trees bordering endless lavender. A trellis sea, or the amaranthine cafe in a cobbled alpine town whose name forever eludes you. The Maillot Jean, pacing ego's deep addiction, beaten daily down and left for dead in a roadside ditch, revived each dawn with a lacerating whiff of mortal salts. An unfazed St. George, enhanced by poison, swords, and molten lead. At last beheaded, where we find him kneeling in that massive pentimento of passion, hanging in his eponymous cathedral in Piran. Every onlooker, executioner and friend, regarding him with shame, pity, envy, remorse, or some variation on the human course of devotion. Too late to grab the artist's brush and revise the drama of legend. Too late to hoist another dragon slayer shoulder high, his eyes alone fixed upon the angels, hovering with uncertain wings, unable to discern a distinction between victor and victim. Fame and infamy, a fabled Bordeaux and sour grapes, circling like vultures above him in a perfect summer sky. And now to invoke the spirit of Señor Lorca, I'd like to read one of my more favorites of his, called The Moon Rising. When the moon rises, the bells hang silent and impenetrable footpaths appear. When the moon rises, the sea covers the land and the heart feels like an island in infinity. Nobody eats oranges under the full moon. One must eat fruit that is green and cold. When the moon rises, moon of 100 equal faces, the silver coinage sobs in the pocket. And on to another moonlit poem, seeing as it's this time of year. We're just back from spring break. This is called Playing Dead. It's the last night of our tropical family vacation, and we're the only ones at the pool, soaking up our final prelapsarian drops before a pre-dawn flight back north to hills still held hostage beneath ashen heaps of snow. The kids are diving for bottle caps, taking turns, holding their breath the longest, their submerged bodies lava lamping in a lagoon of liquid light reflecting a soffit of palm fronds. When the youngest says, "On a scale from 1 to 10, how dead do I look?" And soon everyone's floating on stomachs and face up, reenacting the aftermath of a plane crash over open ocean, or the southern end of Lake Kivu in another April that redefined the dimensions of cruelty. Formaldehyde memories which seem to elude us as we laugh hysterically and snap a grim photo declaring, finally, the perfect holiday card. Then peek at the preview, aghast at the fine line between irony and insanity, recalling that tableau of the Oberbürgermeister of Leipzig. His wife and daughter posed slumped in their Sunday best on a couch and desk in his office in City Hall. Somehow these children look deader than dead, their mock corpses betraying not a single breath of their giddy fun, more convincing than the postcard moon rising over a languid gulf. Leave it to them to make a game of the worst case scenario, to squeeze lemonade from life and death alike, then toast the elopement, the happy couple already enjoying their endless honeymoon, while the joke's on us waiting at the chapel, worrying how we'll ever pay for the reception. Too soon we'll pack our passports, gazing long and hard at fine portraits of ourselves, if only to steal a mortal embrace, sealing painter and model the moment we dip a dry brush tip into our hearts and pull it out, bone dry, not a drip. Unlike the warm, wet skin of young limbs emerging now from their watery tomb to towel off in the dark. Certain, on a scale from 1 to 10, this fountain flows to infinity. Well, here's one we haven't heard in a while. called And Pigs May Fly. I'm boarding my flight home from the heartland, overflowing with hope for humanity and grace of good people I've met, when the red-cheeked man in front of me tries to stuff his oversized duffel into an overhead bin. Unremarkable in itself, except the crumbling resistance he's experiencing belongs to the couple beside me, their garment bag with wedding clothes now being squashed to the size of a shriveled carnation. Rather than seek the nearly empty compartment next to theirs, he removes the couple's bag and hands it to them, saying it sure would help them out. Incredulous, she lays their wardrobe's wrinkled remains under the seat in front of her. Not as if this is a big flight either, where individual motives and ordinary desperation can skulk in a stuffed tin turkey of nerves. Just a crop hopper between Columbus and Cleveland. Airborne, I gaze at the farmer's neat patchwork, where once Shawnee sat on bare ground expecting an apology and got the opposite from Matt Anthony Wayne. What will it take, I wonder? A heart attack? Losing someone close? To bring the minutiae miles below into focus, for him to reach for his ripcord and realize he's shootless with the ground coming up fast. I'm just looking at the gate numbers to see where I gotta go, he announces to no one in particular as we taxi to the terminal, as if his were the sole connection, a reason for traveling, to keep him company and his airfare low. Smile at his impunity the way one regards a basket of severed hands of Congolese rubber slaves. I unbuckle and haul my own carry-on out from under his seat, the dry aftertaste of contrition like salted nuts on my silent tongue. Why didn't I speak up? I could have said something, or from my vantage plagued him for 45 minutes, imitating with the tip of my pen a reconnoitering fly landing on the white heliport of his head. At the very least, I could have winked, a mute solidarity for the woman next to me and her husband who, seconds before the cabin door opens, whips out a Playboy and begins reading. True story. They're all true, right? There's a slightly different location. You might recognize it if you've been to Providence, Rhode Island. Westminster Street. We do not know what a body can do. How when she crossed the street asking you for a dollar so she could get something to eat, you fished in your pocket and peeled a 20 from a sheaf of bills saying, this is all I have. Bless you. You have a good night, she said, and took your hand in both of hers before drifting off into the unconscious city, the wind eddying in doorways of vacant buildings. We do not know the bottom of surrender, swirling our fingertips in an oily reflection. Hope and courage are rolls of unused tickets given away to unsuspecting children as we leave the fair. She wore a dress striped black and white as if darkness were imprisoned, or light, impossible to tell which caused effect or cause, her body and mind knifing one kinesis, her coagulated thought and infinite blood inhabiting the same locus of illusion as she crossed the empty street. We were dreaming with our eyes open, confabulating our nimble, inadequate ideas while strolling after sushi back to campus. Her arms were bare, the air still warm enough to empathize without caring, though the season was turning, about to betray itself. First, the leaves, then snow, giving for once a soft white dam. Then birds vanishing into clouds, taking our naive assumptions with them. A And I think one more before we hear a little bit more music. I think it's time for some music, but I'm going to read this quintet first. We have a lot of kids at home, and we have a little, that means we have a lot of class pictures drifting through, and you must have seen class pictures where, you know, you can look and each face you see, I mean, there's the ensemble shot of the class, and it's kind of hard to see it all. I mean, sometimes you have the individual ones around, you know, the edges like that. That's easier to see them each, but sometimes you have to get out a magnifying glass to actually see their expressions, and, you know, immediately you can tell which, you know, the class clown and the, you know, the brown noser and so forth. But this particular class picture, you didn't even need a magnifying glass. So, sixth grade class picture. At first glance, there's nothing to betray why the principal insists on a retake. The small, orderly homeroom array epitomizes groomed cuteness. Each and every child standing erect and attentive to the echo of mother's voices, putting forth their most obsequious smiles and pristine outfits for what may be the last time before they wend their long, weedy ways toward the shadowy improvisation of middle school selves, lurking in a hormonal forest that even the Grimms refuse to enter. Summer tans nearly faded, these kids are still swimming in their last chance to get childhood right. Though the one in a blazer and Oxford beside the long-haired boy in shorts and a ruined shirt has already entered coordinates and GPS the college he's attending. Though some look as if they might shatter if you touch them, the Riesling white angst stain of homework they'll never finish creeping into one or two cheeks. And there, front and center, beams your own shiny little clone of ambition, hands clasped obediently behind, his smile as innocent and perfectly symmetrical as the rest, his eyes wide and cross-eyed. It's time for a little music. This is our musical director, by the way, Whit Van Meter. Cosmic disregard for bankless rivers. Up till then, you were disconnecting dots, comme tout le monde, counting threads of percale, so your toga could pass for a bed. At the burn unit, they're handing out mirrors for door prizes. In the cancer ward, it's pinwheels. Beatrice still beseech you the way every footprint questions the previous question. Then, till now, was a cinch being the center of a head cheese universe, suspended in a gelatinous matrix, repeating failures ad campaign, ad infinitum, airbrushing zit pits from Taylor Swift's cheek. Now, till who knows when, you're coasting through this new dark age with no handlebars, downloading de colores for the rainbow vote. Soon as the gamelan comes marching in, we'll pick up where we friended ciao. Hello and goodbye will get untrended, going the way of Mr. and Mrs., even Ms., sucked into the tar pit of typefaces, exhausted from hearing their own names repeated. At last they'll trap enough buzzards, affix feathers, and flock south with a desiccated superannuated wintering in the salt flat of extinct Argo, waiting for some unborn poet to wander there, lost with her dropper of vinegar to souse the brawn. That day will be her day, when homeopathic vows dissolve on her tongue, unbridled periods shiver into galloping ellipses of Percy Sledge intervals, abandoning night and day on the doorstep for her young lover's segue, idling at the curb. Sweet surrogate, isn't that what you wanted all along? The planet's lonely, lifeless spiral around the sun's heartbroken song.
A marvelous night for moon dance, but it was a marvelous night for a art show when I looked at some student work, which was in Lebanon, New Hampshire, at the Ava Gallery. And there are a couple pieces that struck me. I wrote two short poems about these two pieces. The first piece was rather large for student work, and it was all white pigment and black. I guess it was pigment. I wanted to say ink, but it was black and white. And as you'll see, it was a figure, and I thought it was very provocative for a high school student's work. It was, as you'll hear, a nude on a stool, and executed in almost Pollock-like gusto. So it inspired in me this type of poem. Slap, pat, jawbreaker of a figure on a stool. Hurry up and slap that meat on the pan, dot matrix. The model ain't got all day, and while the ink ain't dry, the slabs of white pigment stretch like a wall in Morocco you want to hold on to for a while. Sunshine on a shady tree, two halves of here, not here, peekaboo in studio. Flesh, while paint courses down the buxom leg of what's her name? Oh, or supposing his. Where ink stopped, there's what I mean. Where, wear it, worn like potty mouth Play-Doh, ink spectacular. Blot was everything that got you started, when stain was evidence, your pleasure, inattention, remain. getting to know that now that I have two. So the other piece in that show was smaller, and it featured two faces. And this one was a little disturbing to me. I think adolescents should be, we know this not to be the case. There's plenty of dimension to the adolescent. This portrait of a face was half flesh and half skeleton. So, it's called Two Faces. Started with some Lorca, and he read the phrase, recited the phrase, like an island in infinity, like an island in infinity. And that got me thinking about a letter I received recently from an artist, a friend of mine in California, and his last line to me was, Peter, we are all fireflies in the great cosmic black hole. And I think Lorca would like that. I think of these fireflies on the Mediterranean. I tried to write a series of poems, I think maybe I've only written two, about the refugee crisis. And, what connection do we have? What connection do I have to that? Well, sometimes we all want to be rescued, right? But also, shortly after I decided to pursue poetry, I traveled around the world, and I ended up in the Mediterranean, sleeping on the deck of a ship, I should know where these people are, as we would know fireflies in the cosmic black hole of the cosmos. This first one's called Ripple. I guess as you'll hear, I imagine this in the voice of someone on a raft. I could really use you, universe, right now, on this salvage my mules call a boat, where 100 people and 100 more bend backwards to pray.
Give it a try. We haven't actually. I've actually played it all the way through, so we'll see how it goes. Thank you. Ars Cerulean. gone and bound. Today will just have to be one of those days when everything comes out blue. No mystery needs to undress itself. The dark clouds scudding rapidly eastward, revealing every sheen that evades contrivance or composition. I'm on no mission of glory, no path of resistance. The wind will have to weave its own stories. The meadow will have to sing its own weeds, iridescent in the morning. Why force a child to be born? Wielding your scalpel pen, your womb hand ticking to perform an untimely cesarean. Plucking unripe alternatives to ship halfway around the room, a human cargo of medicine. Sit back, relax, and listen to Willie Dixon walking the blues. Man, slow down. We'll get there. Take your time. Chicago blues was a conscientious objector. That Willie Stafford and Stan the Man Kunitz weren't the only ones who laid down their swords and shields, asking to whom can one pledge his allegiance but to the victims. Today is a hoochie-coochie man, man enough to say no, this is not how it's done. Today's dapple dawn-drawn sparrow isn't the only non-raptor sifting thermals, ignoring roadside carrion, circling higher and higher until its wings disappear. Unpopular as it seems, humanity will have to not intervene. Today, the poem itself.
This is a repeat. I guess these are two pieces from this book that I like to offer. The ubiquitous nature of nature. The same nature is kind of strange when we refer to drones, but there's been an evolution of drones. From the bad covert stuff. To the really, you know, dark, but we're not keeping count of you know, who, what, where, to delivering pizza, to delivering sushi, to Home Depot, to finding lost hikers in the mountains. So it's kind of perplexing. I don't know what to think of these things. So in my effort to try to understand what we focus on when we look from the sky. I wrote a series of drone poems. I'm only going to be two, but I stretched them each out a little bit with musical help. A man's alive, And yet it's just as if he wasn't there. Gorky. It is the story of brevity. P-O-M-E. Punctuated through the sound of the implant beginning to climb. Snap, crackle, pop. Oops. And in this old house, the snail of a thing. Poems on a wiry vine. Organic, unsuspecting orb, blind eyes. The oyster in the abandoned bed turned electric flesh, blue and green. The sea telling the shores and cliffs what rights it has. As a boy in Santa Monica practices maneuvers, something like the first electronic keyboards, and sings himself destruction. For the beauty of the skies. The old men modeling lifeguards. Women apparently knitting, drawing thread through charcoal and amplified heartbeat. Calling outsiders to prayer in New Orleans. The bomb, a planet. Guernica, less defined Spanish elegies, we radio options and regret the use of landmines, but offer a cordial, now I can see for miles and miles. And Professor Shorthair picks his nose and pulls a plum, bloody friend, pinned to his shirt. Raising names by obelisk in the cobbled square. You are sexual by history. While Whit's all-purpose supply store boxes of birch separated for aroma. Once burned in the frozen fish in the fished out section. Tasted so good. A composition framed in, free tents, not dumpsters. Open fire! No more Camptown ladies doodah, but golden robes of Fahrenheit. Arrested by the book, paper slips in. Under the roller, a girl hammering a letter, pressed instant messaging. Pounds her own fleshed language through paneling cadence. May they experience love as tongues division and the thought that represents on signs around a thigh gripped fountain pen. Cracked nib, the 19-year-old's lucky dream. Showing up to sort tulips, the shy coming out in honest mouths. Rain rinses salt off a headlight kept by deserted driving. Resurrected, aphrodisiac beads in lavender aftertaste, prayer wheel with stations of the Kama Sutra. But the philosophy student hurries in his parents' Prius, never signaling, a constant green light blinking on Alexandrian screens, submerging for the scent of sea, and seeing the stuff made of movies. I'm trying to pack a lot in these. The original idea was that the page would become a screen with as much detail as I could muster, imagining myself far above, looking down at a population with whom I share the cosmos, but about whom I know little. Imagining these things on my screen, my drone is my voice. Empty streets and hungry faces, footnote now across the universe. Listening, a heart needs a home. This is no 50 cent or swift half copper halfpence. This is real money by flesh and sound. No minimal Mississippi or miles of Nile. Learn behavior and escape routes, grips our gears. She wants to smother the exit light in kisses. The young woman who worked in the fashion industry wears nothing, not covering her legs. And her friend serves time-scented single egg sandwiches from arms fully tattooed in monastic kitchens, uttering patois to the ordinaires of Kashmir. A little cabana and a bike. A woman and flint of choreography. Some progeny Beckett out of his rubber boots and cats and boots and cats and boots and cats. Tell me what this is. Inside this code of conduct, whereas no one notes the faces easily scrolled over. The scholars bet on the game by the worn glove. Where in the map reads poetry. This one note bamboo, aerial bullet softening and wind tunneling to the hollow of core. The audio of one elongated tear. Tear, entering stasis, stream of mother womb, a full nest. Voices in the foyer reveal their sex in Braille. The missing dots of Mutanabe Street's iambs, obliterated volumes by bomb. Yet they sound so alive, those notes talking, and they laugh. Visiting this cute antique town for the holidays, small hope and thankful the relative circumstance, thankful the relative circumstance.
Looks like we've got a couple more for you. This is a new one. It's called Turpentine. And we have a little music by Nirvana, of course.
Thank you.
inspiration.
Thank you.